I pretty much was asked the same question that every child was asked growing up, and I think most of you are subjected to this at some point. What would you like to be when you grow up? Oh God. And like all of you, at some point, I wanted to be a doctor, a lawyer, a pilot, and when I learned the word, an astronaut. But engineer, chef, never quite pictured in the big scheme of things. But this leads me to something that culminated along the way. Having conservative South Indian parents, like most of you, I think whether you're South Indian or not, being in South of India immediately entitles you to either becoming a doctor or an engineer. And I think my parents pretty much had that set for me. And you know, like every journey, we always start with something that is, in a sense, familiarity. And we start our journey at a familiar point, and for me it was going to PSBB, the most traditional Brahmin school that taught me more about schooling than anything else, no other extracurricular activity. At some point here again in school, I discovered that I was dyslexic. Okay, and this was way before Tare Zameen Par, so nobody pretty much knew what dyslexia was. And a really nice teacher of mine discovered that I had some issues, and she decided me to put me in special class. And so special class for me was just a way to get out of prayer in the morning and come late to the first hour. And how did they really arrive at this conclusion? It's because I decided to spell my birthday month wrong. It's April, I was born in April, and I was constantly listening to my Hindi teacher going on April, April, April. And so there was April. And the problem really was that I couldn't spell, and I hated going to school. The only part of school that I really liked was carrying my bag, which I continue to do today for some reason, and getting into fist fights. And that's it. I mean, that for me was school. And of course, hanging out with friends came as part of being out of any educational institution. For me, that was the biggest criteria. Close to home and a lot of friends. So that brings us to the next stage of my life. And I was kind of trying to find my feet with what I liked and what I didn't like. And I was obviously terrible at drama and lousy at math, so I had to probably get some sort of interest. And computers were new back then, so was the internet. And then I decided, while most people were playing Jazz the Jackrabbit, I decided to start doing something cool, which nobody else was doing at that point in time, which was web designing. So I overnight found a guy who could print business cards, and without my parents' knowledge, I started a company. In those days, it was just literally printing a business card called toonstrips.com. Don't capture your vivid imagination yet. It just has something to do with creating cartoon strips and use that as a base to creating websites. So I started my first web designing company when I was 14 years old. Okay, and this is for somebody who knew nothing about numbers. So I taught myself how to program. In those days, it was pretty much HTML and using something called as Internet Explorer, right? So after that, I mean, during somewhere between trying to write code and going to school, I was trying to bake. And my first baking experiment was so wrong, I still can feel effects of it to date. But I didn't obviously talk about it to anybody else, but then I chose to stay away from the kitchen completely. And I slowly started, maybe after almost 2 to 3 years later, I started cooking. I never wanted to do anything with baking in my life. And, you know, you have to make a decision, and then you have to come to college, which is part of the big plan for my parents. So I decided to go to college, just so that I don't have to face the wrath of my dad. And they wanted me to do engineering. So I was like, I said, okay, maybe engineering. At that point of time, I'd already lost interest in computers. I had no interest in food at that point of time. And obviously, you couldn't do food-based engineering back then. So it was not acceptable. So I said, okay, if I'm going to be doing engineering, I may as well try and figure something that I like. And I was forced to change schools because I went to a CBSE school, and they said, you are seriana makku, so you may as well go to state board. So state board meant that I had to leave all of the things that I liked and was familiar with, which is my school, my friends, and go to some place that was completely alien to me and do things that I didn't want to do. So while I've made that transition, I remember just post my board exams, I bought every car magazine on the planet possible at that point in time, went through it trying to learn as much about cars. And I realized I was actually getting interested in these things. So cars, motorcycles, lawnmowers, anything with a motor caught my attention. And that's what I started doing work on. I came up with some pretty interesting ideas, and if you notice, some of my old school books had doodles of just car drawings on it. I wasn't very good at it, but it's what I did. And at some point in time, once I joined college, I was like, okay, this is something that I was kind of familiar with, but it's not something that I'm totally interested in. I joined College of Engineering Indy in the year 2003, and the year I joined, I had a few friends from school that would also join college with me. And I wasn't too happy with the whole system. I mean, going to college, being graded for something that you don't like doing, obviously you're not going to be very good at it. I mean, that's the way I looked at it. I don't want to do things that I don't like doing. And right after all that, I said, it's okay, but what am I going to learn over the next few years? And when I started looking at the main reason why I joined mechanical engineering, which is to do something with automobiles, what I learned in my summer holidays in 10th standard was a lot more than what I was seeing in my final year. How is this going to motivate me? What am I going to do? And this is when I started introspecting about my life, and I was like, everything that I've learned so far, I've taught myself, and I think I'm pretty decent. I mean, I've made money doing things that most people, most kids at their age wouldn't have dreamt of. And now I'm talking about automobiles, which most college professors think is a difficult exam to pass. So I needed validation. And this came up when I started my next company, which was X Concepts. This was my third company. In between, I'd also started a real estate company for some weird reason. But the thing is, it did pay off. I had some savings. It helped me put that money into a concept company. So we started saying, let's build concept vehicles. And all of this started taking shape when I had a spinal fracture at the end of my second year and I dropped out of college. I took a year off, and during this time, when I was in bed, all I would do was design. And you know, my validation really came up when there was a fair in Germany where I designed the world's first motorcycle made out of granite. It's the most absurd thing, but it was a stone fair. And you know, at that point in time, everybody was trying to explore what different uses of stone could ever be possible. And then we said, well, let's make a bike, which works. We got a lot of attention. That's a snippet from the Hindu, 9th of July, 2005. I was pretty excited, but then came the big blow. I'm like, if I can do this, what am I going to learn out of college? And then this is the biggest issue that I was seemed to be facing. I was trying to lose interest, lose focus on pretty much everything that I did. And getting back to college meant that I have to go through Math 1, Math 2, Math 3 all over again, I'd failed Math 1 and Math 2 in my first year, so which meant I had to go back to class again to do Math 1 and Math 2. This is kind of getting to me. So the decision of saying, okay, I'm not going to do math or whatever else, and I felt I peaked and I was really bored, okay? So one day while sitting in math class, my love for cooking was kind of stirring me, and I said, okay, maybe we should do something fun, maybe something to do with food. And you know, it was I think all timing when the professor asked me to leave class for doodling and not doing math work. I got out and I realized I'd written the word sinful something at the end of my notebook. And it basically was going to be the company that I was going to start next, okay? And that's what we did at Sinful Something. We made European desserts. While I was still in college, I'd go back and bake. I went to college merely for the attendance standpoint and nothing else. I still hadn't dropped out of college then. It was the second time, only because I didn't want to face the wrath of my parents and social issues. Imagine going up and saying, oh, what do you do? And I said, college dropout. Not a very exciting thing to say back then, right? Now I think because of, you know, social network and movies like that, being a college dropout is, I think, a lot more acceptable in society if you're doing something cool. So I didn't really understand what sinful something was going to gain for me, because it's a really tiny store. I had a friend's mother helping me run the store, and I do the baking as soon as I got back from college. So which meant no time for college work. Which meant my grades were falling, which means I was failing even more. And so I decided to take that leap of faith. I wanted to say, you know, to what, to hell with society, to hell with systems, to hell with my parents and what they think. I'm going to drop out and become a chef and run restaurants. And this was kind of fueled a little bit by, you know, the fact that I wanted to prove to everybody that I could be successful, a successful dropout, more than anything else. So I said, now it's time to find somebody to fund my passions. And together, I found a couple of investors, and we opened one restaurant and bought over another. Big mistake. Both of them went down so fast and so hard that it kind of left me hurting. And I was sitting at a place where I didn't know what was next. I didn't know what I was going to do and why these restaurants failed, because in my head, they were the perfect concepts. And during this point of time, I realized that, well, I started the restaurants for all the wrong reasons. I started the restaurants because I thought I was good. And I started the restaurants because I wanted people to know that I was successful. This word success, at this point of time, kind of caught my attention in a really negative way. I'm like, who gauges success and how do you gauge success? So I said, with all of my last savings, sold all of my real estate positions, sold my stocks, sold one of my companies, and I started my last ditch effort to salvage my pride more than anything else. And I said, the only way I'm going to have any sort of attention that I'm going to give to this new baby is if I put my name on the door. And we started Sandy Chocolate Laboratory. This was my baby at the time. It started with 12 seats, and I'm like, if I can fill these 12 seats continuously for 5 months, I'll open a larger section. And you know, after the first month, we were busy. We had 2-hour waits, and things were going right. And it was being now this, I was getting validation for the fact that I thought I could cook, and something was right was happening here. And you know, now 5 months had passed, and we started hitting new milestones. At this point in time, I was just replicating things that had worked. I was opening more restaurants, more formats, simpler things to do, making it easier for myself, and saying, you know what, I have a successful business. At this point in time, my parents were completely pissed off with me. They were like, what is this guy doing? He's becoming a chef, and whatever, he claims to be a chef. He started two little restaurants. My parents come from a mining background, so they can't completely relate to what I'm doing. So society looks at me and saying, oh, you're a hotelier now. It's like, it's not a hotel, it's a restaurant, and it's two completely different things. And I don't want to be a hotelier. So, and you know, after a point, you start retrospecting these decisions to a point where you realize if what you're doing is right. You start judging your own self-belief at this point of time only because people around you are giving you new ideas, new things to think about. And at this point, you're like, is it really worth it? Is it really interesting and important for you to be doing these things, right? And this comes to, you know, again, that little question that I kept asking myself from the time that I started Sandy's. What is success? I mean, and why is it so important? And I said, well, I know my business is stable. I know I could go on and create more things if I wanted to, but am I happy creating what I'm creating? That's when I decided to flick that switch off in my head and said, you know, I don't care about success. I don't care about the number of restaurants I own. I'm going to make sure I hone my craft, and I'm going to really, really work on perfecting my skill and start putting out food on the table that I'm proud of. And now I started feeling like a chef. I stopped thinking like a businessman. I started thinking more as a person attuned to doing something with food. And this led me to a lot of new discoveries. I mean, we were discovering new techniques that people around the world hadn't seen. And we were talking about putting that in a conservative market like Chennai. People were accepting it. We also, in the process, opened a lot of new interesting restaurants. We opened India's first ramen bar. I mean, ramen is a Japanese comfort food, and we opened the first ramen bar in India, and that too in Chennai. People thought, you know, it's going to be one of those failures, and I was like, at a point, you know, you don't care. You will have failures, and those are just really mile markers to make sure that you know you're on the right path and you're heading in a direction. They're literally used for course corrections. If you feel strongly about something, I think you should go ahead and do it. So that brings us to, you know, the journey itself, and I think that's what we're all in it for. We walk down a path with a particular thought in mind, and travel for travel's sake. And you know, you have a particular direction, and you want to move in that direction. And usually, you know, most of these travels and thoughts are marred by one word: passion. Everybody is like, "Oh, you're so passionate about it. You can do it. That's why you're so good at it." Okay, so passionate, when I hear the word passion, I'm like, okay, so being passionate is about being cooking. I mean, is being able to cook, right? I'm like, imagine you being passionate about peeling potatoes. Can you do it for a whole month? I think I'd get bored after the first day. Well, but unfortunately, in a restaurant kitchen, you have to peel potatoes a whole month. You have to do the same process over and over again. You have to be able to blanch those tomatoes the exact same way and do it time and time and time again. Because the customer doesn't care how many times you're going to do it, as long as, you know, every time they come back, it tastes the same. So I decided to change that and in my head make a mental note and say, stop being passionate about it, start being committed. Because passion is an emotion. Commitment is something that you have to give yourself to be able to do something right and do it right. And again, this brings me back to my favorite word, success. And I think it's so overrated. And and it becomes so subjective after a point. You know, everybody's talking about success as a measure, but it's not. I think it's what you want it to be and how successful you want to be. The question is, are you happy? And I think more than success, I think it's really the journey that counts. Thank you very much.